I'd like to call the meeting of the Public Accounts Committee to order and to begin for the day. We are meeting this time as our last meeting scheduled for this year, and we're pleased to have with us the Department of Health. We have Mr. McNamara, the Deputy Minister of Health, to talk about mental health services. So I'd like to begin the meeting with introductions, if I could, beginning with Mr. Epstein.
Good morning and welcome, Howard Epstein, MLA for Halifax Chibucto.
Good morning, Sid Press, the Eastern Shore MLA.
Larry McKinnon, MLA, Pictou East.
Leonard Pereira, MLA, Halifax Citadel, Sable Island.
Keith Caldwell, MLA, Preston.
And Diana Whalen, MLA, Halifax, Clayton Park, and Chair of the Committee. And we're joined with our support.
Evangeline Coleman-Satt, Assistant Auditor General.
Jacques Lapointe, Auditor General.
Darlene Henry, Committee Clerk.
Patricia Murray, Acting Executive Director, Mental Health, Children's Services and Addiction Treatment.
Kevin McNamara, Deputy Minister, Department of Health.
Linda Penny, Chief Financial Officer for the Department of Health.
Well, thank you very much. And as is our practice, and I know, Mr. McNamara, you've been here a number of times in this year, you have the opportunity to begin with an opening statement for us. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Good morning, and I'm pleased to be joined by Patricia Murray, who's the Acting Executive Director of Mental Health and Addiction Treatment Branch, and Linda Penny, our Chief Financial Officer. It is my pleasure to speak to you this morning about mental health services in Nova Scotia. An audit of mental health services was recently completed and released by the Auditor General. In that report, the Auditor concluded that the Department of Health has not shown sufficient monitoring and evaluating processes for mental health services that are being delivered throughout this province by district health authorities and the IWK. As well, there were concerns that the standards set by the department were not being met. The Department of Health has accepted all 19 recommendations made by the Auditor General and has already begun work in some areas. Over the past 10 years, the mental health budget has increased. For the year 2010-11 fiscal year, the mental health budget is $121.9 million or 3.4% of the overall budget for the Department of Health. However, it is 8% of the funding provided to district health authorities and the IWK. Over the last few years, there have been several enhancements to mental health services. In 2005, the Early Intensive Behavioral Intervention Program was introduced. This is a program to treat preschool-aged children with autism spectrum disorder. The program has been independently evaluated with very positive results. Currently, the program serves about 60% of eligible children. The Adolescent Center for Treatment at the IWK, which provides rehabilitative mental health in a 24-hour residential setting, has increased its bed capacity from 12 to 18. The Mobile Crisis Team, which is a partnership between the IWK, Capital Health, EHS, and police, was expanded to provide 24/7 service to all of HRM, where initially it only served the metro area. As well, crisis early intervention response has been enhanced in all other districts. The Involuntary Psychiatric Treatment Act came into effect in 2007. It was designed to balance involuntary admission with the patient's right. In addition, there was the option of community treatment orders, which allows for involuntary patients to be treated in their own community. As a legislative component of the Act, the Patient Rights Advisor Service was established as well in 2007. The role of the Patient Rights Advisor is to ensure patients understand their rights and to assist at patient review board hearings. We know that the IWK Health Center has a long wait list for regular referrals to mental health services. While there have been several innovative programs introduced to address the wait list, the complexity of the referrals is increasing, so it will continue to be a challenge to meet the established wait times for regular referrals. We are also working on a wait times project. We are at the stage of validating the data, and the first information will be flowing from this system this fall. In the throne speech, government made a commitment to revamp mental health services in the province, and the recent announcement of the co-chairs for an advisory committee that will develop a mental health strategy will help meet this commitment. We hope to announce the full committee and the terms of reference in the near future. The community-focused living initiative will be a part of this strategy by providing Nova Scotians who are recovering from mental illness with the proper accommodations to facilitate the transition from hospital to the community. The completion of this facility and its 40 beds will also give Capital Health more flexibility as they make changes to improve both inpatient and community-based services. The mental health strategy will also look at the need for community-based supports accessible across the lifespan. Having the right resource and supports in communities can reduce the number of readmissions and improve the quality of life of patients. We are also working with Acadian Affairs to ensure we are able to reach French-speaking people in Nova Scotia, as mental health information has been identified as being important for all to access. We've also provided some funding to the Health Association of African Canadians. As we put more on the emphasis of primary health care services and encourage a collaborative team approach to the delivery of these services, we are working with the primary health care branch to be involved in collaborative and shared care services, which will enhance access to mental health services. In closing, I want to say how committed as a department we are to making sure Nova Scotians have access to the mental health services they need when they need them. I'd like to thank you for this opportunity. Patricia, Linda, and I look forward to answering your questions.
Thank you, Mr. McNamara, and welcome back to the legislature. As I was saying to you earlier, you've been in this legislature so often in the last year that we should name that that seat after you. In any event, it's 9:08, and as is our practice, we're going to start with the Liberal Caucus. 20 minutes, Ms. Whalen will start.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. And again, welcome this morning to Mr. McNamara and your staff. This is a subject, of course, that's had a lot of interest in the legislature as well. Mental health is something that affects, one in five Nova Scotians and one in five Canadians at some time in their lives. We know it's pervasive, and it is an issue that has been largely overlooked because of societal issues, because of stigma, and probably for many reasons it hasn't had the same attention that other diseases and other illnesses have gotten. And for that reason, we're glad to see that the Auditor General has done a report on it so that we can bring it here today and look at it in more detail. Certainly, some of the findings were troubling, and we've talked about the lack of resources in the past for mental health and the fact that it needs to increase. And I'm pleased to see in your opening statement, I may go to some of the figures you've given us, because you indicate that there's been an improvement. But we're still looking at about 3.4%, I think is what you said, for this year's budget on the spending for mental health. The other concern that was raised in the Auditor General's report was really his, under the significant audit observations, was the information denied during the audit. And I just wanted to ask a few questions about that before I go into some of the other initiatives and spending items that are, currently underway. So I really wanted to ask you specifically how you were notified that you were not to give information on the budget requests that were made to Cabinet.
My understanding is the advice came from the Clerk of the Executive Council.
And would it have come to you directly, though, Mr. McNamara, as Deputy Minister?
It would have come to my predecessor and to our staff.
Okay. So the request was made before you were in place?
I believe so.
Okay. But you've been in place this entire year, have you not? You were acting as Deputy Minister?
I've been here 11 months now, yes.
Okay. So you began in August of last year, is that right, or July?
July.
July. Okay. I wonder if Mr. Lapointe could tell us when the audit might have begun for this mental health.
I would say October, November.
Okay.
Last year.
In 2009.
Yes.
So, I mean, that sort of challenges the timeline a little bit, but, I know as members of the committee, we often are not aware of the work that the Auditor General is doing or what timeline he's on. So that's why I did ask that question. So if, in fact, it was happening in October or November, could you perhaps clarify what the what the communication channel would have been to make such an important decision not to release information?
My understanding that this has been a consistent practice, through advice from the Executive Council over the past number of years. I don't think there's any change in policy from the past. And as I understand, it's being worked on, it'll be rectified for the future.
I understand, yeah, there will be a change in legislation, perhaps, to clarify things. But I understood that the Auditor General has always received information like that in the past, that this was unusual.
I can't answer that question.
No.
I don't have that information.
Well, his report seemed to indicate that it was unusual not to receive information that would have been budgetary in nature. So would it be possible if I could just ask you once more, is there any, are you able to tell me how this was communicated to you and the department that you would not be releasing that information?
There was a discussion with the Executive Council, with all deputies, about information that was considered privy to Cabinet and which was available to be released, and it was part of that advice.
Okay.
Overall.
So would the advice have been just through a meeting? It wasn't written advice?
No, it was through a meeting with deputies.
It was through a meeting with deputies?
Through a normal deputies meeting.
Okay. You know, I know that you're in your first year of being a deputy minister, but would you normally have made that kind of information available if you had not had that advice? I mean, with the Auditor General doing an audit in your department, I would assume that the attitude is to facilitate the work that the auditor's doing.
That's normal. And what we would do is I would seek advice on certain activities, whether it's from our legal counsel through others, depending on the information that is asked for. Mm-hmm.
In the absence of that directive to all deputy ministers, would you have seen a problem in providing that advice? Just what he was looking for was just requests, budget requests.
It would depend on the question that was asked. I'm not being evasive. It depends on the question that's asked of us. But I do know, for example, in the sense of having even worked through a district health authority, information that goes to Cabinet, even from a budget request from a district, is considered confidential to Cabinet.
Okay.
And has been in the past.
Just further on that budget question, or that, you know, this similar idea, it was said that there were specific requests to Cabinet for the mental health budget. Are each of the budgets done individually to Cabinet, or would you not have a global figure that's going up to Cabinet?
In preparing a budget through to Cabinet, we would put a number of things through that we would like to advance for consideration or give options. And for example, we would prioritize some of the options that we may have. We may look at, for example, whether you're dealing with funding a new drug, whether you're funding a new program, whether you're funding expansion of a certain service. So you go through a number of options. And through that, we end up eventually with a budget that we can approve and go forward with.
So if indeed you had some additional spending in mental health, that would have been highlighted then, because that would have been one of the options to be changing or introducing new programs under mental health. That would have highlighted it?
I think it's safe to assume that there would be requests for expansion of funds in a number of different areas, including mental health, throughout the budgetary process. Mm-hmm.
And if there hadn't been any new initiatives, it wouldn't really have been highlighted, because it would have been static, isn't that right?
That is correct.
That wouldn't have been one of your, you know, kind of options or the formulas that you could be playing with if it was going to stay static.
If your question is, do we ask for specific program expansions or specific areas, we do.
Mm-hmm. And I would be safe to assume, I think I heard you say, that mental health would be one of the areas that you would have requested additional.
There'd be many of the programs that we would be looking for direction and advice on going forward for expansion.
Among the mental health?
Among the mental health.
Okay, well, that's something in itself. All right, I appreciate that. Again, looking at some of the recommendations that are in the report, there were a number of them that are looking at dollars again. I wanted to ask you about the costs associated with the DHA compliance to the mental health standards. And as you know, a lot of the report talked about the standards that were set in 2003, I think. And at the time, there was a $20 million budget or expected cost if you were going to achieve those standards and be able to monitor those standards. The Auditor General looked at it again in 2007-08, and it had risen to $23.5 million. What I'm wondering is if you have a cost today in 2010-11 that would be associated with me those standards.
I'm going to ask Linda Penny to speak to that.
Thank you.
Okay.
In looking back at the budget that we had in 2003-04 and the increases since then until the 10-11 budget, we've actually added $26 million in additional programming costs to mental health. So any of those programs would help advance the standards.
Okay. So you're saying that the overall spending increased by $26 million?
The overall spending actually increased by about $29 million, and okay. There would be wage increases in that number, but the actual program increases were 26.
So if you took the salary increases out, it was $26 million in new programming?
Yes.
Okay. I wonder why in 2007-08, the Auditor General was still saying there was a cost of $23.5 million. That the cost to meet all your standards had risen to $23.5 million. It sounded like it was still a gap, that he was indicating a $23.5 million gap. Would you read it the same way?
I would certainly read there's still a gap. You know, when a $20 million number is set 10 years ago, inflationary costs would impact that.
Mm-hmm. And have you tried to look at what the gap is today or in this budget year?
I think I'd have to defer to Patricia on the gap.
For this budget year?
No. Is there a recent year that you would have looked at it, like the year before or perhaps?
I think the $23 million would be the most recent that we have.
07, 08, that was. Okay, well that gives us some idea, exactly. I had a specific question for Mr. McNamara about the Department of Health, and it is just to ask you again if the Department of Health did approach Cabinet with a request for additional monies to ensure compliance of the health standards, mental health standards. I mean, knowing that that was something you set 7 years ago.
I think that would be part of the advice from Executive Council.
So that's sort of private advice. Okay, confidential advice. Okay. Just had to ask. Fine. Can you tell me what specific actions the department is undertaking to ensure the mental health standards, if any, are being implemented? If you have any actions, I'd like to know some of the specific actions.
I can give you some. What we have done initially is we went through the recommendations from the Auditor General and first identified those actions that we could ask of each of the DHAs. A letter was sent to each CEO requesting them to comply with those as best as possible or to identify, and when I'm meeting with them on this coming Friday, we'll identify if there's any issues or any difficulties with meeting those, but I haven't had the feedback at this point in time. Also, the branch is reviewing all the recommendations and seeing how we can move things forward. And the minister has made a commitment that not just through this year, but through the mental health strategy to ensure we incorporate the recommendations from the Auditor General's mm-hmm. report into that.
Okay. So really, your actions right now have been to ask the different directors in each of the DHAs for their plans to meet the Auditor General's recommendations.
As it relates to each of them, correct? Mm-hmm. And then secondly, as to our department, we'll also be reviewing all the recommendations and what we can advance forward, and also looking through the mental health strategy that we're bringing forward, how we can meet the Auditor General's mm-hmm. report. There will be a report at the end of that we'll be taking to government, which obviously will include a request for some resources.
Mm-hmm. So even though we adopted those standards 7 years ago in 2003, we don't seem to have any implementation plan even today within the department. Is that fair to say?
I'm going to ask Patricia to respond to that.
Okay.
Ms. Murray?
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
We have been implementing the standards ever since they were introduced. And so all of the DHAs are aware of them, and everyone has a copy of them. Any new staff are made aware of them. Hiring practices, the competence level of the clinicians hired, all of those things are laid out in the standards, and those have been followed ever since they were introduced. I might also say that there was a huge group of people that contributed to the standards, from consumers to clinicians to psychiatrists, administrators, and department staff. And so we got a good sense of what they should look like on the ground when we began, and then the expectation was that they would be implementing them all along. Mm-hmm. So we do assess that every year to see how close they come to meeting the standards, and with no additional funding, they're only able to meet them to a certain degree. But I can certainly assure you that every DHA is aware of them, and they are implemented to the best mm-hmm. the DHA is able to do that.
I'm sure you're aware of the very low compliance rate when they did the audit and did a sampling of, I think, over 300 different files to see how many of them were meeting the standards. It wasn't even 20% that they found that met the standards. Would you say that some of the standards are too vague or too difficult to even monitor? I think that the Auditor General found something to that effect, that there were some of them they weren't even really able to test.
Yes, I would say that probably is a challenge. I would say we're the first province in Canada to introduce mental health standards, so we were sort of breaking new ground when we developed them in the first place, and we were trying to ensure that everyone had a good understanding of the ones that we did begin with. I would think now is a good time to take another look and to come up with more specific performance measures, which I would say the current standards aren't always clear on, so that we're comparing the same thing across districts, and we're in the midst of doing that now, actually. We'll meet monthly, and we'll make sure that we go through all of the standards to make sure that they're easy to measure and easy for districts to know if they're compliant.
Okay, so you are going to review the measures now, and
yes.
I'm gathering that would be because the Auditor General's pointed out that some of them really aren't measurable, or
yes.
Certainly would be a challenge to measure.
They're a challenge to measure,
yes.
And I think some people may interpret them slightly differently, so we have had feedback every year, but it's been more anecdotal than actually being able to measure, so I think that there would be a challenge in being able to make those connections. And given the low compliance rate, they did look at hundreds of files, but there are thousands. All across the province for mental health clients. So, and given some of the specific ones they looked at, and given that they were challenged in terms of how to measure them, I would say it would be hard to come up with a true compliance rate.
Yeah. I think in defense of the report, though, it did say that they eliminated the measures that they felt weren't, they couldn't track, and so they just eliminated those and tried to go to the ones that were more hard and fast, and even in that regard found that there was a very low compliance rate, and that would be looking at wait times, and you know, there's quite a list of the standards that are in the report on page 61, but I know you've been through it, I have no doubt about that. With the setting of standards, and I appreciate that we were first in Canada to do that, but with the setting of standards, it should have ensured that we get the same level of service in each part of the province.
Yes.
If you've set a standard and you're trying to keep everybody to that,
yes.
Then you'd have equal access, which is really important, and a consistent provision of service.
Yes.
What I'd like to know, and I guess the question would be for the Deputy Minister, would be that in your own opinion, is there equal access and provision of mental health services today in our province?
Is there equal access?
Is there equal access
it
and consistent service?
It is different in different districts for various reasons. For example, if you take the Cumberland region, does not have any inpatient beds, which would be different. But and I think that's something we have to look at, is how we can best provide resources around the province, not based just on the districts, but also on the resources that are available to be able mm-hmm. to ensure the service is there. It's one thing to say, I have a service in a place. It's another thing to have the appropriate staff mm-hmm. to make sure you carry out that service. But there is strong mental health services in enough districts to be able to ensure patients do get access. Mm-hmm. And we do know that individuals who require emergency services are well looked after. It's where we have some difficulties is in some of the wait lists for those that are trying to get in and aren't at that crucial stage yet, and that is one of the things we have to work on so that we can prevent more people getting sicker while they're on a wait list.
Right. So given that if you had an emergency or crisis, you said no matter where you live in Nova Scotia, you would be seen and helped at an emergency department.
And transferred to an appropriate facility.
Right. Is there any corner of the province where you feel they are disadvantaged beyond Cumberland? And I'm hoping that inpatient beds are made available at neighboring DHAs.
They are made available at neighboring DHAs. But we do have some challenges in staffing in some areas. So, for example, the opportunity to see a psychiatrist in Yarmouth is not as great as in some of our other districts. I'm not sure there's one there now, is it? So when you have one psychiatrist, it is very difficult to ensure you have full-time service. We supplement it by family practitioners who have some expertise in mental health. But this is something we have to work on and see whether we can continue to provide that service in that similar way or look at a different model to ensure people do get access to the appropriate services.
Okay. Yeah, I do understand, and I'm sure there'll be more questions about Cumberland since I see my colleague is here from that area. But what I did want to go into as well, I know I just have a few minutes left in my round, would be the transition from child mental health services to the adult system. And the Auditor General has pointed out that it is not always consistent from one DHA to another. He mentioned some of the DHAs allow a smooth transition and others put you back on a wait list when you become an adult and you then have to wait again for service, which could really, you know, have somebody completely derailed if they're doing well and they're receiving the services they need and then they suddenly have no support. So I'm wondering if that would be a critical area for you to be looking at right now in light of this report and what steps you're taking to do that.
It is definitely an area we have to review and make sure that we make the service seamless for patients between children and adults. And we also are working with our partners at community services of how we can deal with complex cases, because that also creates some issues for us when individuals change age and how they may be looked after. And some may be under the purview, for example, the Department of Community Services, and then transfer as an adult to the Department of Health. And we're working with them how we can improve that system for the future. There's a bit more work to be done, but we have started a process of how together we can better look at individuals and make the service seamless. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'd just like to say that certainly even in my own riding and with people I know, this has been an issue and that here in the Capital Health mm-hmm. District, and I didn't know if it was isolated or more pervasive, but I think it is an urgent matter because we know there are a lot of young people mm-hmm. and I realize, Ms. Murray, you deal with youth, there are a lot of young people where mental illness presents itself. And so those critical years when they're in their late teens and early 20s, you know, really become a critical time to ensure that they are able to get a handle on their illness and function fully. So, you know, I can't stress strongly enough that I think it's really important that not be an issue, that we not have people left without service or, you know, I think it's really unconscionable to put them back on a waiting list at that point. I just think that we need to be cognizant of the continuum of care. And that's silly. If we have a great IWK system, which we love, if we have that in place, we shouldn't lose it as we're moving into the adult system. So, I'm very, very keen that we look at that. I think I have less than a minute left, am I right?
About 15 seconds.
Well, I think I better just say thank you, and I'll have some more questions in the next round.
Thank you, Ms. Whalen. We'll move next to the Progressive Conservative Caucus, and Mr. Clark. It is 9:28.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair, and I want to extend a welcome and greetings to our attendees here at committee today. And as you've indicated, have been familiar faces in the last little while here at Public Accounts. One of the things I just want to look at is with regards to revamping your mental health services and thus the strategy around it, how much statistical analysis and data has been presented or is provided with regards to persons with addictions that have mental health? Is there a charting of that or statistical analysis?
I'm going to ask Patricia to answer that.
Are you asking what information we're using as we go forward with the strategy, or just what information we have available?
Well, the correlation for mental health services and the fact that, oftentimes persons with mental health issues also have addictions related to that are either compounded or result because of either behavior or patterned activity. And so I'm just wondering, is there a body of information that has analyzed that?
There is information on that, and I don't think I can pull the statistic out of my head at the moment. I'm thinking, 30 to 40% possibly. It's quite high. There's a high correlation between addictions and mental illness for sure.
Right. And one of the things that we currently have ongoing, and is this, I know in looking at gaming in the province and the gaming addiction, I mean, this house has had much discussion about that. And while this committee has precluded the gaming corporation to coming here for consideration, I would have been happy to ask them about statistical information that they would have hopefully have had their disposal of what they currently are doing. And more importantly, if another strategy is being undertaken by the government. So my question is, with the new gaming strategy, what level of engagement has occurred to this point? on that new strategy with relation to mental health services.
I will respond to that. In the new gaming strategy, both the Deputy Minister of Health Protection and Promotion and myself will be part of the larger team that's going to be looking at this. So it's in the preliminary stages, so I can't tell you any output from that committee at this point, but we will definitely be involved in advocating on behalf of both mental health and addictions as we move forward. I think it's also fair to say there's many things that do interrelate between addictions and mental health. And for example, a sexual assault of individuals also is a high proportion of individuals end up in both addictions and mental health as well. So we have to try and do a better job at getting at the earlier stages, and gaming obviously is one of them.
So just, Madam Chair, just for the record, so there has not been any formal engagement at this point?
The committee is being set up, and we are to be on the part of the strategy. But there's been but I haven't been to a meeting as yet.
Okay, and so the outside consultant that's been hired to undertake that, former Deputy Minister Ron Lesperance, has had no discussions at this point with you, or
not as yet. But I understand one will become upcoming in the future.
Okay. So in advance of that, what has been the level of involvement by the Department of Health with the Gaming Corporation with their current or existing strategies at this point?
It has been more through health promotion and protection than through the Department of Health. But in moving this forward, one of the things that in talking to the Deputy Minister of Finance is making sure both departments are involved, meaning health protection as well as health, on the go forward.
And just with regards to, I guess, some of the next steps. So if we go back to the fact that we're in a situation where we haven't had the benefit of having the Gaming Corporation, that would have been helpful, I guess, to be a preamble to the discussion here today. That's not the fault of anyone that's presenting as witnesses to the committee today, but it is part of the issues that we have to contend with within committee and dealing with the government to deal with an established process that we would have hoped to have had in place to properly consider these matters. Having those matters voted out at committee level is not for the witnesses' issue here today. But with the Gaming Corporation, we've all known, and when dealing with addictions, but again, tying that back to mental health services and where those dots connect. And you had referred to the minister, the Deputy Minister of Finance. Can you detail what the role of the Deputy Minister of Finance has been with you and your colleagues?
The only, as I indicated, we in our discussions to be part of the committee to look at it, but we haven't had a meeting, so I can't give any further details than other than I will be at the table.
Okay. So have there been any other, so what you're saying is other than the statement made by the minister, and I guess the Minister of Finance being responsible for the Gaming Corporation, other than the statements that the government have made at the political level, there's been no engagement at a civil service level?
Not at my level, and not for my involvement. There may be other civil service involvement that I'm not aware of.
Right. Okay. So, and do you have a list of the departments that are participating as part of that strategy and the working committee?
I know health protection, ourselves, and finance, possibly community services and justice, but again, I'm speculating in the last two, so I don't want to be perceived as given a fact, but I'm not correct.
Right. And I'm just wondering, Madam Chair, if the deputy might be able to provide, through his colleagues, just a list of who's participating with regards to that strategy.
We can do
just
that.
Just as an information request to the committee.
Okay, very good.
We shall do that.
And one of the things that I guess that relates to dealing with strategies, and this is I guess more of a core overarching issue of which your efforts, which are very important, relate to, and that is in one of the concerns about government cherry picking of topics in terms of what strategy moves where. And one of the difficulties is looking at what the connections are between the various strategies. You know, as we all know, it cannot be helped with governments that we talk about the silos, and working committees are very important, and deputies working at that level is to be applauded. And one of the things that we're trying to come to terms with is what is the overarching aspects of this. Obviously, the Department of Finance, aside from the minister being involved with gaming, would have an interest in this, but the financial resourcing of supports and services for mental health issues, and as they relate to other sub-tiers. So we have an area where we're trying to help people, but at the same time, the people being helped are being drawn upon to finance, through the Gaming Corporation, by virtue of an addiction, revenue streams for the province. So I think there is an interesting connect about how governments deal with problems that are presented in society, that they're putting money out to try to correct or service a problem, and at the same time are drawing revenue from those same individuals that are being impacted by the addiction. And I'm just wondering, when you work at the deputy level, is there a discussion about, you know, the cost of what's really the value of doing certain things in terms of government pursuing a gaming? With mental health services, if you talk 30-40% of people that would have related addictions, of course, alcohol, drugs, gaming, in fact, probably a combination of all of the above would be impacted there. And I'm glad to hear that community services hopefully will be engaged, because that affects another tier of people that are further impacted. But from your point of view, are there recommendations that come forward for mental health services that are involving activities of government that you recommend that should no longer be pursued?
As I indicated, we haven't had a meeting as yet, so there has been no discussion on the topic. But I would say, from a personal point of view, what we will be trying to advocate is for the patients that we look after, and trying to recommend the best that we believe will improve their life on a go-forward basis. But until we have the first meeting, I can't give you any more details.
Right. No, okay. I'll accept that, Madam Chair, and not pursue that angle any further, other than to say that I think with regards to the mental health services, it is something that we'll be looking at eventually whenever this committee should have the Gaming Corporation come before it, and whenever the working committee and the outcomes flow to this group. And part of one of the things I would note, and again, not with our witnesses, but for the committee's edification, is that there is a connection here about why the government did not want the Gaming Corporation before this committee, because it's obvious what was stated as something that was well along the way of process is actually not in process at this point. And it's not the fault of our witnesses, but it is something that is telling about the agenda setting of this committee, the issues we've had to debate at this committee with regards to where the government said they were versus where we are in dealing with topics. I just would like, before passing over to my colleague, and I know he has some regional issues, as was referenced in the last round, I know a lot of efforts, and just within the Cape Breton district, a lot of good initiatives are being transferred out to a regional basis. And I'm very pleased that today the Premier's down, they're opening up the new cancer center, all of those transfer services that can be done at a regional level. Can you just provide some updates of where we would have had more centralized services in terms of progress being made of getting a wider level of service out into the regions? Do you feel like you've been able to mark a good measure of progress for, I guess, regional services and mental health services, but really getting to the local level of helping individuals within their districts?
Do you want to take that, Patricia?
Sure.
Ask Patricia.
Thank you. The way we've designed our services is through a network model, because we're aware, because of our small population and generally rural population, that to provide equal access and to provide adequate services around the province is challenging, especially for the more serious mental illnesses. So we have a network model set up, which means that in every DHA, there's someone identified that has an interest in that specific area. So say eating disorders, early psychosis, that kind of thing, and they meet regularly either through teleconferences or through providing educational sessions, and so they keep their skill level up, and they also have a network of colleagues that they can call on if they get into a particular difficulty with a client. And all of those have specialty clinics located in Halifax where they're close to an academic setting, but they're able to refer their clients in for a second opinion, for additional assistance with treatment suggestions, to clarify a diagnosis. So that model has actually worked very well, and we have it in place for all of our specialties. specialty services. And otherwise, we have mental health clinics around the province, and we have up to 50 clinics, both in major centers and in other smaller areas through satellite clinics. So folks aren't generally very far from home when they can access services.
Right. No, I'm pleased to hear that. And I know that even with the last topic, with regards to gaming and mental health services, that even justice would be at the table, because with mental health services, the Justice Department has played a role. And I know the previous government, which we were proud to be part of, and my colleague started sitting next to me, the member for Cumberland South, with our boots to the street, one of the things that we understood from hearing the community was the need on a policing level for people to be educated and better adept and able to deal with persons with mental health issues as they are impacted or have to be engaged with the justice system. And I'm sure that as a result of the Hyde inquiry, we will have a number of other things that will flow out that we're going to have to put into place. And one of the things that we were able to do is put a policing officer in place that worked and trained with the DHA, with the mental health services area. And we were committing further through the Boots to the Streets initiative to add to that off to another level of officers that then could be, you know, training other officers with regards to that, but also somebody within the system that could be engaged to help and to hopefully be ahead of. So it's like, in some ways, it was initiated. I'm sure the Hyde inquiry will provide us with a number of recommendations, but we'll also have working models now within mental health services that are going and are working. Regrettably, the government has chosen to cancel the Boots to the Streets program, and the additional officer that was to be hired within the Cape Breton District Health Authority, I don't believe will be put in place. So one of the resourcing issues is it is a multifaceted. And I'm just wondering, have you had any further discussions with it when it comes to mental health services with justice about the connection of providing policing services with service providers within the Department of Health?
Ms. Murray?
I know with our mobile crisis team within the Capital District, policing is actually part of that team, and they've trained with the team. They have gained a better understanding of mental health issues, and they go out on calls if they're required to assist people right in the community. And I also understand that there's an online policing resource available that Dr. Bianca Horner developed that any, I think, police officer has access to around the province that they can do as they're able through an online education system. So I think there's a lot of recognition that policing is a very key part, and I think the policing resources themselves have identified that it's a need, and so it's been provided in a couple of different ways, and I would say that that is ongoing.
Well, it's my hope, Madam Chair, that there'll be an ability for the department to look at where the model has worked currently, and where we can be able to include that. Because one of the things is to recommend to the government that they actually come back and actually bring back the Boots to the Streets program, so that these types of what other people thought were discretionary decisions were actually strategic investments to provide policing services, so that they actually are a mental health provider navigating the justice system to get better outcomes for everybody. And that's an aspect. I know it's not for our witnesses to have to do that, but they do work with their colleagues, and we will be calling upon the government to reinvest in that, and hopefully the Hyde inquiry will give us further insight that the government will have a plan forward and to link these pieces together yet again. So with that, how much time is left, Madam Chair?
4 minutes.
I just refer to my colleague for Cumberland South then.
Mr. Scott.
Thank you. Thank you, Madam Chair. I want to as well thank our guests for being here today. It's a tremendous opportunity, I believe, to discuss an issue that's very important to many, many people. I know myself, you know, for almost 13 years, I've been a member of the legislature. One of the most frustrating issues I think that can come before an MLA is someone who is desperately seeking some help, who is suffering from an illness for the most part, in society, is something that's not taken on as it would have if it was cancer or many other issues that we see so much public outcry over. And I know it's very frustrating for myself and extremely frustrating for those who are suffering from that illness and their families. So I think it's a great opportunity to be here today. And I do have some questions around Cumberland County. The deputy mentioned there was a discussion earlier about beds. My question is, the first question is around beds for Cumberland. Presently, And I'm sure that you would agree that, you know, someone who is suffering this type of illness who can't even find that type of resource close to home, it's a further stressor for them to have it's challenging in regards to the illness itself, financially. You know, it's a long way to travel to find that resource in another county, and presently without beds in our area. And I'm sure you'd agree that that further compounds the issue. My first question is, with the additional long-term care beds that are being allocated throughout the province, thanks to the previous government, I'm wondering if someone can answer a question around, for example, All Saints Hospital in Spring Hill. We seem now that we've allocated additional long-term care beds, should free up some bed space in some of our local hospitals. Is it possible your department could consider a small number of beds, at least for Cumberland County, for example, in All Saints or one of the other hospitals in Cumberland?
Mr. McNamara.
Sure. I think what we have to do, well, part of the strategy is to look at what resources we presently have and then what resources we can utilize, and also looking at what available resources are already available in our province, no matter where it is. I know when I look at Cumberland County, with a population of probably 32,000 people in 5 hospitals, there's certainly opportunities for us to look at how we can allocate some resources versus some other districts that wouldn't have the same ratio of beds to our facilities to the number of individuals. But I can't give you the specific answer today, but I think we have to look at all options. I think one of the things we believe in is that first you try and do a service as close to home as possible, but also at the same time ensuring you have the appropriate resources to support the person that you have there. It's no good having a resource without having the appropriate trained personnel, i.e. psychiatrists and others, to provide the treatment.
You have a minute.
Thank you. 1 minute?
Yes.
Hopefully I'll come back later. I appreciate that, Deputy, and one thing that I think, one of the challenges I think we face in rural Nova Scotia when it comes to attracting professionals, and I'll use GPs, for example, in my own area. A lot of times, general practitioners will come to an area of Cumberland, for example, but they have a spouse who's a professional as well, and that spouse is looking to follow their career choice as well, and a lot of times those opportunities are there. I'm wondering if the lack of ability to attract the type of professionals for mental health in Cumberland could be attributed possibly to that type of scenario, and if it is it something your department's looking at of some ways they may help to alleviate that?
It is one factor. There's numerous factors, but sometimes the spouse not having a opportunity for a position is definitely a factor.
So would you agree that the government has a role to play, whether it's education, health, or could be transportation? Other departments have a role to play to try to ensure that for us to be able to attract professionals, for example, in an area like Cumberland, other departments are going to have to get involved as well to ensure that if a spouse is a professional, there may be opportunities for other departments. So would you agree the government should have the departments involved in those issues as well, particularly in rural areas?
From a former CEO in a district, we used to explore every opportunity, whether it's with government departments or private employers, to find positions for individuals. And most districts do try that.
Your time has elapsed, Mr. Scott. Yes, but you will have another opportunity in the second round. And I'll turn the floor over to the NDP, and we'll say it's 9:49. You have 20 minutes. Is it Mr. McKinnon? Yes, thank you.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. It's great to have these witnesses before us this morning on this very important subject matter. I'd like to, wherever possible, advocate for rural Nova Scotia. And what I'd put forward this morning is how do we ensure that services are available to rural Nova Scotians, remote communities, in the areas of mental health, and that support is there for their children who need mental health services.
As I was saying before, the first opportunity is to try and provide services as close to home as possible, and that includes rural communities, but also does, or I guess is important for the department to ensure that when we do provide a service, that we provide the appropriate service with the correct standard. I mean, you heard earlier that we talked about standards through the Auditor General or not meeting. Some of that, we can probably say that we may not have the appropriate resources, i.e. individuals, in place to make some of these things happen. And I think we have to look very carefully at making sure, first, that when we provide a service, that we provide a quality service, that individuals are going to get the appropriate treatment.
And efforts are being made in relationship to outreach to those communities that I'm talking about that are somewhat remote.
Correct. And some of our rural districts provide a very good mental health service. They do different strategies to make it happen. Some of them have great relationships with other departments. For example, we were talking earlier about the Justice Department. I can think of my former district where the police department from RCMP, the mental health services, myself, met on a regular basis to figure out how we can make things best for a patient who might be impacted by the justice system, and also so that we didn't become a liability to the police, because sometimes, for example, with a difficult patient, if you use the police as your security, it impacts what service they can provide in the rest of the community. So we used to work hard together to try and reduce the frustration for both sides and yet and treat the patient with dignity.
We have 13 First Nations in the province, a very integral part of our population demographics, and First Nations with a growing population as well. What I'm asking this morning is, are there outreach or special services targeting Aboriginal Nova Scotians, and in particular, Aboriginal youth?
I'm going to ask Patricia to answer that.
Ms. Murray.
Thank you. I believe that through the Aboriginal Health Transition Fund, several new projects were developed, and many of them were related to mental health, and several of those were related to children and youth. So I know that some of our district health authorities are working very closely with the First Nations communities in their area. I know Cape Breton works very closely with Escasonia. I know in the Colchester area, they work closely with there too as well. And I believe down in the valley too. So I think there's a growing recognition that's certainly a need. And so I think all of the directors of mental health services are certainly aware, and they're reaching out to their Aboriginal communities to try and make that happen.
Thank you for that. I'd like to talk for a moment about the partnering that takes place sometimes with the Department of Community Services. And the role of the Department of Community Services in relationship to funding of some mental health area programs. And I use as an example the Schizophrenia Society of Nova Scotia recently seeking some funding from the Department of Community Services. So what I'm talking about is the relationship that exists between the two departments. In my constituency, an advocate for the Schizophrenia Society of Nova Scotia, Cecilia McRae, is taking great leadership efforts with that society and is becoming a real activist and a lobbyist on behalf of that society. So what is the role of community services in relationship to mental health?
Ms. Murray to start, would you like to?
Yeah, I'll start.
Oh, sorry, Mr. McNamara.
To Patricia to finish. One of the things is we are working with the community service, and particularly the Deputy Judith Ferguson, myself, to how we break down the silos of what's happened in the past. Not that there hasn't been some partnerships, but we're trying to do it through a number of issues as we move forward. We do have individuals that we would consider, I'll use the word complex cases, and how do we ensure that that individual has a good experience through the whole continuum of care, whether it's transferring from them to us. One of the issues you're always struggling with is, who does this patient belong to? Is it a community service client, or is it a Department of Health one? So we're also breaking down those silos. So it doesn't matter who pays for it, let's figure out how we'll provide the best service for the individual. Then we'll figure out the payments as we go forward. We are working with some assistance from individuals from the Government Policy Board to develop a go-forward policy on those type of cases. But I would say it is a partnership, it is getting better, and our commitment is to do the best we can for Nova Scotians. But maybe I can ask Patricia to answer a little bit of what has happened in the past.
Ms. Murray.
Thank you. We tend to say that the Department of Health is responsible for funding health services, and the Department of Community Services funds support services such as housing and assisting with daily living skills and that sort of thing. So it gets to be a challenge when you have a particularly ill individual who stresses the Department of Community Services group because they're not always comfortable managing that illness. It may be that the illness the person with the illness doesn't need to be hospitalized, and so to be fair to them, they need to be managed within the community. But that's where some of the difficulty comes in. And to be fair to the staff in DCS, it's a particular skill set that you would need to have to handle some of these more difficult clients. So I know that the Nova Scotia Community College is introducing two new programs that should assist with that, and they will provide the adequate training that these folks will need to actually be able to manage them in a home-like setting. And so I think that will really enhance the quality of life for these folks and help with the working relationship so that mental health can provide the mental health piece and community services can provide the housing and support piece.
Well, thank you for the clarification. I think the more that we can do in a lot of areas to get rid of the silos, the better it will be for the province and the people of the province. What I'd like to move to now is sort of looking at what's happening in some of the other provinces and to ascertain what kind of dialogue is taking place between provinces and what best practices may be emerging from some of those dialogues that are taking place, because I assume that there is regular interaction between provinces to ensure that we all advance in this area.
Mr. McNamara?
Yeah. Thank you for that question. One of the things that we're trying to look at, and we have a regular discussion at ministers and deputies meetings on a national basis, how we can work together. One of the things that we will be doing this fall is holding a mental health summit here in Nova Scotia for Atlantic Canada, which will involve all the ministers of health for the four provinces, and getting some individuals who can give us some ideas of how to look at how we can work together. We've also talked about how we can try and do some of our strategy more closely working together, because some of our individuals cross our borders on a more frequent basis. But it isn't as easy as we would think, working with different governments and in different provinces. Sometimes it's hard enough working with just different DHAs. But we are moving that forward. The second thing that I can say is that the Mental Health Commission of Canada has been working on identifying things that we can work together on. And I happen to be in a fortunate position of representing Atlantic Canada on the Mental Health Commission that's led by Michael Kirby. And the executive director is Louise Bradley, who used to work in this province before and well knows our issues here. And as a matter of fact, the minister and I are meeting with both of them this coming Friday just to talk about some ideas on a go-forward basis. So yes, we're trying to learn from others, but there's still a lot of work to be done.
Thank you very much. We all have important questions here today on an issue that is so vital to the province and its people. However, I must share my time, and I pass it off to the member for Halifax, Chautauqua.
Yes, Mr. Epstein.
Well, thank you very much, and Deputy and your staff, thank you very much for being here. Like my colleagues, I also regard this as a serious matter. But I wondered first if we could start with trying to clarify some of the terms that have been used. I wonder if you have your copy of the Auditor General's June report with you, and if you do, I'd direct your attention to page 50. This is the initial section in which the Auditor General starts to discuss mental health services. If you have that, you'll see that in paragraph 4.4, there's a reference to the Institute of Health Economics, which suggested in a September 2008 report called How Much Should We Spend on Mental Health? There's documentation that mental illness accounts for more than 15% of the disease burden in developed countries like Canada. And then the paragraph goes on to say that in Nova Scotia, really, we only spend about 3.4% of health expenditures. And I'm wondering if you have any comments on those numbers, particularly, I guess, the 15% disease burden. Can you help us understand what's being said there?
I don't have the science on that, but what I can say is that, yes, it's 3.4% of the total Department of Health budget. It's 8% of the district health authority spending. So, but we all know that there's more resources required in order to move this forward. We're also looking, as I mentioned in my opening comments, about how we can tie primary care more into mental health services, how do we can utilize was one of the things that isn't recognized, even when we talk about the percentage of expenditures, is the percentage that is provided by other individuals out in the community, for example, through general practitioners. We know that they meet with some individuals that have mental health problems and do treat them. That's not part of the expenditure part that we would be showing or identifying. But again, I'm not a health economist, but I just know it's there. It's an intuitive, but I don't know if Patricia can add anything further to that or not.
Well, it would also be, oh, sorry, thank you. The disease burden would be broader than just health, so DCS picks up a piece of that, justice picks up a piece of that, and education does. So our funding is a certain portion, but they would all be contributing to assistance for persons with mental illness as well. So I think it's spread more broadly than just health.
Yes, I mean, my concern about this paragraph in the Auditor General's report is not that it directs us appropriately, which it does, to the need for some more spending when it comes to mental health issues. It's the proportion. The casual reader of that paragraph would come away thinking that we really have to quadruple our spending because of this term disease burden, which is used in this report from the Institute of Health Economics. But I went back and looked at that report from the Institute of Health Economics, and when it talks about disease burden, what it means essentially is shortening of life. It's really an economics term, and is far from clear that that's the appropriate measure in terms of numbers of dollars that any particular provincial government in Canada should be spending on a particular topic. And when you read through the whole of that report from the Institute of Health Economics, they come down at the end, and I think there are copies available for you and others there, and I'll pass copies down to the opposition parties, that really the bottom line for the Institute of Health Economics is that the appropriate measure is still to be determined, and that when you look at different ways of approaching it, it looks like maybe 6, maybe 7%, and Nova Scotia isn't really much out of line with what the other provinces are spending. Is that your understanding, that Nova Scotia is about in line with what the other provinces are spending?
If we look at the report that came out from IAG on how much we should spend on mental health, it shows that across the country it's about 8% in total is spent on mental health. So if we're using our funding to the DHAs, we are in line. But I think it's also recognized that in every province we need to improve our services to mental health patients.
Well, I was certainly agreeing with that. I wasn't disagreeing with that. I think that's the starting point for everyone. The worry that I had when I read that paragraph in the Auditor General's report was that in linking the 15% number or taking that 15% number as a starting point, there was a strong suggestion in the report that that should be the benchmark. And I have to say that I see nothing in the underlying report that would support that. Anyway, moving on, I do have some other points and questions. The one stray one is, I wondered, I didn't hear, Deputy, in your opening comments, a reference to the early psychosis program, which I think is run at the Capital Health District. And I wonder if you could just bring us up to date as to the current status of that program.
I'm going to ask Patricia to respond.
Thank you.
Thank you. The early psychosis program is alive and well. It is based out of the Capital District Health Authority. It's supported with psychiatrists, a GP with a particular interest in psychiatry, and other mental health professionals. I believe it addresses the needs of youth and young adults, so from 14 to 24 to 26. The idea with early psychosis is if you can identify it early, you can make a profound impact on someone's life. So it's a critical service to provide, and I think they do a very good job of it. We also have some folks out in the community who are closer to the ground and able to identify some of these young people. We have a nurse who used to work out of Phoenix House that now is associated with the IWK, and she works with a homeless population, and she's able to identify when those young people are quite ill, and she can get them into the services that they require. So the idea is to get them treated almost with their first episode of psychosis, and then the outcomes are very much more positive for them. And if they're not treated early, then the outcomes are much more negative, and very serious harm can happen in those early years that prevents them from really making a full recovery or taking as great advantage of the services that are available as they're older.
Thank you. One of the well-recognized problems associated with the overall system for dealing with people with moderate to severe mental health problems is housing accommodation. And I'm just wondering about your linkages with the Department of Community Services and service providers in the community that do have housing programs available. Is this something that's left entirely to DC? Or is it something that the Department of Health has some involvement in as well?
Oh, we certainly have some involvement in that too. We work quite closely together between the Department of Community Services and the Department of Health. From the Department of Health's point of view, we are putting in the community-focused living units in Dartmouth, and that's 40 beds that will accommodate those coming out of the hospital setting and transitioning them into the community. Community services calls on us sometimes because they have many facilities that house persons with disabilities, and they may need our assistance with managing some of those people. So we're always open to working together with that and making sure that the individual gets whatever services they require. So if they require mental health services when they're living in a community services facility, they certainly have access to that.
I'm wondering if the department has a model or favors what I would call supportive housing rather than just housing. By supportive housing, I'm meaning housing that has preps in place, whether it's 24/7 or for a shorter period, someone who is able to work with the residents and try to meet their needs beyond merely the housing housing needs.
Yes, they have a variety of services available. So they do an assessment of anyone coming into their system to determine what actually they need. And so some of them need very little support, but they do need a place to stay and they need people checking on them. And some of them need much more 24/7 support. So I would say that they determine their level of need, and then they have a variety of settings that are able to provide a variety of levels. And then mental health fits into that in terms of what the mental health need might be, and so that's provided as well.
Yes. In the various projects that exist, it's not clear to me where the funding responsibility might be divvied up. Are there some projects that is housing projects for those with mental illness that are the financial responsibility of your department and others that are DCS? And if so, where's the dividing line?
Generally, the housing piece is DCS.
So is there any money coming from your department? I had the impression there was, but I wasn't sure how it gets divvied up.
More and more we're trying to sort out that piece, like who should be paying for what. And sometimes, as the deputy has said, it's less important about where the funding comes from, but we just want to make sure that the person gets the services they require. So I would say on an individual basis, when we have particularly challenging cases, the complex cases, we certainly do that and we share those costs. And the community-focused living units may well involve a piece from DCS, and there may be other things coming down the road.
Thank you. I see, unfortunately, my time is up. I'll have to yield.
Now seven.
I yield my 12 seconds.
Thank you, Mr. Epstein. I believe we are going to move into the second round of questions, and we have 14 minutes for each round, starting with Ms. Whalen.
Thank you very much. And there are still many questions to be asked. I know, as the other members have said, this is an area of great concern to all of us. And again, because of the prevalence of the just incidence of mental illness, and also the fact that there are long wait lists and difficulty in accessing services. I wanted to go to the subject of communications, and that was also highlighted in the report from the Auditor General about how well people can find their way through the system, whether they can find the right numbers to call and how to reach people. And although there are a lot of numbers on the website, I think we have to recognize that a lot of times when people realize they need to get help, they are in a crisis or things have come to a head, and they often are not going to be in a position to wade through the website to find the different possibilities in their DHA. One of the things that I'm often struck with is that people don't even really know which DHA they're in. If they were to look at a list of the DHAs, you know, it's not always clear, and certainly not by their numbers. So what I'm wondering is how we're going to address that in the future. One of my questions would be that with the new nursing number that you can call, the telehealth number, the 811, that people are beginning to use that. And if a person were to call that when they were in distress, you know, either for themselves or for a family member, what information would they be getting for mental health? And has the department addressed this?
Yes, absolutely. We gave the nursing group a bit of an orientation before they started answering the calls. And we have some plans to continue to do that. We're going to provide them with mental health first aid training so that they have a better appreciation themselves. We've also identified in their directory all of the appropriate numbers that they can be referred to and the people that they are to call to simplify it for them. And they have a whole protocol and to know how to proceed. If it happens to be a crisis situation, they can quickly get them to a crisis where a crisis assessment can be done in whatever DHA they're from, through 911 and through getting them into the emergency department. If it's less pressing, then they can send them to the one contact number within the district that they are to call, and then it's sorted out then their level of difficulty and urgency and when they need to be seen. So I think that will be hugely helpful, and I think they are getting more and more calls, and we've been very careful to have that directory accurate and up to date so that the information they're given is the best and the most efficient way to get into the services.
Okay. I'm glad to hear it's up to date as well, because things change so quickly that this is important. Have you any sort of sense yet of how often this is being used? I realize the telehealth just began in July of 09. I believe it was July it was launched. So have we got any sort of statistics or any sense of how often you're getting mental health calls through that number?
I asked the same question in the past week, actually, of our 811 folks. We're not quite there yet, but they are looking at it because they are recognizing that they're getting more mental health calls, I think, than they thought they might. And anecdotally, it's certainly been identified. Something will be coming out once they've completed their first year, which is coming up. So we will get more information on how often that's used, and I think it'll just increase.
Can I ask, are they tracking their calls so that they know what sort of issues are people are using the telehealth for?
Yes, I think they have a very sophisticated tracking system where they can easily identify who's calling in.
Okay.
And about what.
So that should be clear then. If it's a mental health issue, it should be very clear what the numbers are at the end of the first year.
The one challenge will be that people will call in not specifically expressing that they have a mental illness, but may call in for something else. Mm-hmm. And the idea would be, if it's possible, to give them suggestions for a variety of things they may access, or help them understand, you know, what service might be most helpful. But generally, if someone certainly calls in with a mental health issue, it will be identified as that.
Right. Thank you very much. And maybe for Mr. McNamara, we'll go back there to the issue around having up-to-date information. And it was noted in the report 4.75 that this service and program information was not always communicated to physicians. And so they didn't have up-to-date information. We talk a lot about the physicians and the primary care being, again, your first opportunity often to identify mental illness, and that the family doctors need to be better prepared. So what has been done in regard to that, Mr. McNamara, to address the communications issues with doctors?
That is an issue that we will be addressing. Sorry. And and we'll try and make sure that that is available to all physicians. I mean, we have to do some work to get it all together. So we're in the process. It's not complete yet.
Mm-hmm. Had doctors complained that they don't have up-to-date information? Had that ever come up to you previously to the Auditor General's report?
Not through me as a deputy. Now, going back to my days as a CEO, at times you'd get queries from physicians saying, can I be made aware of all the services that are available? Or sometimes, how do they get access, even when the service is known? Because they felt sometimes, I'm talking from a GP perspective, sometimes they felt that the response was not as quick as they would have liked.
I have a specific question around the amount of remuneration that we give doctors, if the family doctors, if they're dealing with a mental health issue. And we know that doctors are paid a set amount for each visit that they have. But if you're talking to somebody who has mental health issues, you can't write them a prescription necessarily and send them out the door in 5 minutes. You really do have to sit down and do some time with them. I had recently visited a primary health office, I guess a doctor's office, and was told that they are limited to something like 4 times a year that they can see a patient on mental health issues. Can you tell me anything about that? And if not, maybe could you get the information for us? They were allowed a higher fee for seeing somebody if it was to do with mental health. And I think they're allowed to spend half an hour with that person or 20 minutes, I'm not sure the exact amount, but a longer period of time can be allocated. But if they do spend it with them one time, they can't see them again for 2 or 3 months, which isn't really an effective way to use our doctors as a front line of delivering mental health service. And I hear more and more about the shortage of psychiatrists. And the psychiatrists are saying a lot of times, you don't need to see us and you don't need to see a psychologist. You need somebody who has mental health training, as you suggested, about even our frontline telehealth medicine. They can also know how to intervene in a mental health issue by having special training. And our doctors, I think our family doctors, just need some, you know, professional development perhaps, and they would be able to do a lot of this and provide the hands-on care that a lot of people need in the community. But not if we don't pay them to do that, not if we don't allocate it in their fee structure. So it's certainly a lot cheaper to have a family doctor spend time with a mental health patient than it is to send them for an hour with a psychiatrist, which is, you know, going to be a much higher cost. They're specialists and also harder to get in to see because of the wait lists. So I'm wondering if you are aware of this, if you could comment on it, and if you don't have the information, if you'll get it back to me.
Yeah. None of the three of us here are aware of it, so we'll have to follow up on it for you. But I will add that as we're trying to change more into collaborative practices, as we're trying to move people more to an alternate funding program, that we can ensure that the individuals get the time they need with the physician. I do recognize that some physicians, for example, will see people within a very short, limited period of time based on the fee-for-service schedule. But I also know other physicians spend the needed time with their patients regardless of how they're paid. Mm-hmm. And so it is something we have to work on and improve. So it's, but I will check that fact. I don't know.
Yeah. Well, I've simply been to quite a few of the conferences, and I'm sure it will come up when you do your conference in the fall, about trying to use the other people in the mental in our healthcare system to do their maximum, the contribution really towards the care of mental health. And if we're doing that, we have to look at how it's going to be structured and whether we can allocate the proper time for family doctors in particular. And I know there's more and more being said about that, even about counselors in schools. And there's a pilot project, I believe, in Digby that I think we should note today that is trying to empower teachers to identify early psychosis or mental health issues and intervene early. And that is, I hope, working well so that we can expand it to other schools, because I think it's a way that can be done in a very cost-effective way to identify and help people at an early stage when, you know, it hasn't become a full-blown crisis for families.
You have no argument from this department on that.
Yeah, exactly. Can you tell me, with the conference that's coming up in the fall, if that is part of your mental health strategy? Is that tied into what you want to do in terms of mental health strategy?
It wasn't meant to be part of the mental health strategy. We're talking about the summit, which was,
yes,
it came up at our first meeting of ministers of health in Atlantic Canada after the minister came in and I as deputy. And at our first meeting, the minister proposed that we look at trying to do something on an Atlantic basis. And the intent of the summit is to try and use some, it's an opportunity to bring in some outside experts to give us some information to think about how we can expand our services on a go-forward basis, to look at some of the new trends that are coming up in mental health. We know, for example, that there are vulnerable populations that we sometimes don't think about. Some are surprising. Some, like, for example, I can give you one example from an individual that I heard speak was talking about individuals who are doing quite well, and if they lose their position or jobs, that they're more vulnerable sometimes to suicide than individuals who have...
Absolutely, yes.
So to give you an example.
With the recession, exactly. Yeah. On the mental health strategy, I'd just like to ask what amount of money you have allocated to begin the study, and I realize it's just mapping out a plan, but still, can you tell us the budget for the mental health strategy?
The individuals who will be serving on the committee will be doing it at a gratuitous basis. The budget we're probably looking at in terms of the support that will be necessary is probably in the $100,000 range.
Okay.
But again, that's a soft figure at the moment.
Very good. Can you give me a timeline for when we'll see a mental health strategy, you know, announced?
Our belief is to have the next July is the date that we're aiming for.
So a full year, it will take a full year of study. Okay, that's
one,
fair.
One of the things behind it I wanted to mention is we want to make sure that that it's research-based and evidence. So it's not just based on opinions. It has some solid information right behind it.
Would that $100,000 include any consultants that you might be engaging to support the work of the board?
It will not be consultants in the terms of consultants. We hope to use the Research Foundation to provide the evidence to help us move forward.
Very good. I appreciate that. On the issue of the finances, and I know we don't have time to dive right into it, but the difference between the 3.4% that you say of overall budget of the Department of Health and the 8% that the district health authorities are spending on mental health, I'm wondering if you can provide to the committee, because I know you can't, you know, go over it all right now, but can you give us later a breakdown of the spending on mental health in each of the DHAs? And then your overall dollar spending here in the department as well, and that way we'll get the total number of I think you've got there 121.9 million is being spent on mental health. So if perhaps you even have it, was it provided in our package?
Yes.
Oh, very good. Maybe you'll just give me a copy afterwards. Sure. We get overwhelmed with our packages; they give us so much at once. But anyway, I definitely wanted to have that breakdown. So I appreciate that. On the issue of finding your way through the process, I think I just have a minute or so left, but I wanted to ask about the idea of a navigator for mental health. You know, it's been tremendously successful with cancer care, and you would be aware of that from your previous experience, and I know that the patients find that invaluable, to have somebody that walks them through what can be a maze of different specialists and offices and locations, and I think with mental health, there's a real problem about finding the right services, knowing who to call. I think there's still a question that people who are better educated or better connected can find their way into the system a lot easier than the, you know, a person who just picks up the phone book or goes on the website and tries to find out where to get help. So we need a navigator. Have you looked at that?
Not per se in terms of mental health, but I think what we have to do is utilize all the healthcare workers out there as navigators, regardless of when people show up in our system, whether it's to a primary healthcare network, whether it's to our acute care system, or to one of our mental health branches. I think individuals can be, if we provide them the appropriate information, can be navigators to everyone. When we become more specific or specialized, we tend to lose some of the importance of being able to deal with individuals across a number of services. For example, we've talked about some individuals may have addiction, some have mental health, some have some chronic diseases. And how do we do this together? And I think we have to stop doing things in silos and start looking more collaboratively.
Mm-hmm. Well, I do agree with that, but you're not supporting the idea of a navigator at this time, then?
Not at this time, no.
No, the cost would be quite, I think, manageable if you look at just, you know, a few in the system that could do that.
Every service that comes up is manageable until I start aggregating them up.
Yeah.
It becomes a difficulty.
I think what was pointed out...
Ms. Whelan, I'm sorry, your time has expired.
Too bad.
Thank you. We'll now move to the Progressive Conservative Party, and Mr. Scott, you have 14 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and I just want to begin I want to start off with a question for the... I wanted to pick up where I left off with the Deputy of the Staff, but I want to ask the Auditor General, if the Auditor General in his review and audit, particularly of healthcare monies, if he looked at whether he felt the amount of money spent on mental health per capita is fairly spent between rural and urban Nova Scotia, considering the large geographic area, obviously, of our province, and did you actually look at whether you believe that the money spent through health for mental health per capita was fairly distributed throughout the province.
That wasn't part of the of what we were examining, so I wouldn't really have any information on that at all.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, Auditor General. Do you ever do that in your review of departmental spending? Do you ever look at what's spent in the central part of the province versus what's spent in the outlying areas, and how budgets are distributed, whether they're through other parties such as DHAs, whatever?
It would likely, if we were looking at that, would likely wind up being outside of the area in which we could give opinions. Quite often, the decisions on that kind of spending and the allocation of spending likely be areas of policy or other practicalities that it would be very hard for us to make decisions as to whether it was appropriate or not.
Thank you for that. Just back to the deputy, I guess, and staff. There's a couple of articles. One article, it's in the news, the evening news of October 1, 2009. I'm just going to quote Dr. Stephen Ayer, says, executive director of the Schizophrenia Society of Nova Scotia, said, because of the stigma associated with mental illness, there's been no push from the public to focus on improving the system. I wonder if you could tell me, Deputy, does the department very often receive concerns from throughout the province in regards to the non-availability of services in certain parts of Nova Scotia from either mental health patients themselves or their families?
We do receive concerns from individuals, from organizations. I mean, Dr. Ayer is a very strong advocate, and appropriately so. I think one of the things that we need is more people advocating. Even as my predecessor had said, I think when you were in government, was that individuals should be advocating stronger for mental health services, which helps government and us to respond to those needs, and so we do welcome that. I think but there is areas where when individuals are impacted that they make sure that they let us know of the impact on them or their lives.
Thank you. And again, in the Chronicle Herald article, March 9, 2010, the headline says, the long road to mental health. Services sparse or non-existent in rural parts of the province. I'm wondering, Deputy, if you could tell me if, in regards to priorities for the department, in regards to mental health, where would you say that statement says a lot? And I'm wondering if you could tell me, in your list of priorities, where you would see providing services. I heard you say earlier about closer to home. I was really pleased to hear you say that. You know, and if the answer was easy, it would have been done long ago. And obviously, it's not neat. It's a huge challenge. I understand that, and I will tell you that I'll be the first to, if you and your staff are able to address this long-standing problem, I'll be the first to congratulate you, because it's something that's been long-standing for many years, and I understand that. I'm really interested to hear where you believe that statement, the services are sparse or non-existent in rural parts of the province, where in your list of priorities for mental health, where you kind of see that issue fits?
Well, I think the first issue is on the first point of contact. And for example, if I use Yarmouth as an example, they may have which they do have an inpatient unit, but when you have one psychiatrist, then, for example, you don't have the services that could support a full 24/7 type of service if individuals need it, because you've got one individual who can't obviously work those type of hours. So that does create an issue for us. We do know that there are parts of the province that, because of the resources available to us, we do not have the services we'd like to have. But if we can work better through primary care, work better at getting to individuals earlier, and we are exploring some opportunities. Is there some new ways, for example, of being able to deal with our youth? We know, for example, that many young people access information differently than we in my age group. For example, I read the newspaper, they use Facebook. So we have to look, is there ways that we can use those new modalities to try and get to young people earlier, to let them know first of what services are available or how they can connect into the assistance that might be available to them, or even how they can work together as self-support groups.
Thank you. I have to keep referring to Cumberland, but I think Cumberland County, to me, would create the same challenges. For example, you just mentioned Yarmouth. A lot of times, these communities are counties that are not surrounded by other Nova Scotia counties. just in itself is a challenge for them when it comes to attracting professionals and providing services, because you don't have the opportunity to reach out around you. Really, you only have one direction to go within the, if you're going to stay within the province. And I also want to say as well that the District Health Authority in Cumberland County does a tremendous job. Bruce Quigg is the CEO. He has a wonderful staff. They have a great board. They do a fabulous job. And they face a lot of challenges as well. I note that I believe the amount of money is allocated for Cumberland County is $2.4 million. Does that sound right for mental health?
Ms. Penny?
Yes, 2.460.
Thank you. Could you explain to me how that works? Do you allocate that 2.460 as part of their global budget, and then are there core programs that are identified by Department of Health where money has to be spent, or is there some discretion? Do they have some discretion in regards to how they may expend some of those dollars?
They can't spend it outside of the mental health field. So there are some core programs that have to be spent on those particular programs, which Patricia could speak to specifically. And then there would be a non-portable mental health block of funding, which would give them a bit more flexibility. So it's all within mental health.
It's all within mental health. And are those dollars each year annually, are they always spent fully, the full amount allocated to the DHAs?
I would say very close.
I'm going to go back to the...
Sorry.
Sorry, Mr. McNamara?
No. I'm sure they have lots of places for it as well. Just go back to... I mentioned earlier about All Saints Hospital to you, Deputy, and All Saints Hospital is a hospital that also has as well an addiction services, which to me would seem to go hand in hand with if there was an opportunity to reserve at least a couple beds in that facility for mental health. So my question was, if the DHA saw a fit, would they be able to allocate some of that mental health monies they received through their budgeting to enhance, for example, the opportunity for other services, for example, All Saints, whether it was a couple beds or whether it was to provide services, professional services, would they have the flexibility to be able to do that?
I can answer that. Linda Penny said, the money that is allocated for mental health is non-portable. So that, for example, they can't have. But they can take funds from a portable budget and enhance their mental health budget. So that they do have that option.
Thank you. And I'm not suggesting that they have additional funds that they don't have a place for, that they could do that. I was just curious if they would be able to, if they saw a fit and there was an opportunity, if they would be able to use those for mental health services in Cumberland, but maybe in a different way that normally is being done today.
My understanding is almost every district supplements the non-portable money with portable money.
Yeah, I'm sure they do, because they're very creative there as well in regards to finding dollars to support programs that they see a need for in the county. I just want to switch a little bit to talk a little bit about corrections. Cumberland County is unique as well in that we have the only men's federal institution in Nova Scotia, in Spring Hill, in excess of 400 inmates, where the federal government would actually provide for federal services of all types. And one of those would be psychiatric and other issues that inmates would face as they spend time in that institution. I'm wondering if your department's ever looked at the possibility of sharing services in Cumberland County for residents with the federal government.
Obviously, we haven't to date, but it's a suggestion to look at.
I appreciate that. I'm just going to, as I said, we have a federal institution there. We have presently a provincial institution as well, until this present government saw fit to remove that service from Cumberland County, thinking that the residents of Cumberland County no longer need that, which is obviously an issue of disagreement amongst us. Those incarcerated provincially require services as well. My understanding is there may be some contractual agreement between the province and the feds in regards to using those federal services. It would make sense to me if we have an issue around bed space, if we have an issue around being able to attract professional services, for example, in a rural area like Cumberland County, And there are other service providers, i.e. in this case, the federal government is providing that service. It would make sense to me to look at forming some sort of a partnership. I know this, my discussions with them over the last couple of years, the federal government was very interested in forming partnerships in regards to providing services for provincial and federal, both inmates who are incarcerated and as well staff. They were very interested in pursuing that. I'm sure they'd be very interested as well, I believe they would, in regards to providing services through the community, whether it's through a contract or whatever. So I would ask, Deputy, that you would at least take that under advisement and at least have someone in your department follow up to see if there is an opportunity, because there may be an opportunity to provide service in Cumberland that's not there today, but is there in a very secure setting that's at the federal institution. The other, I mentioned earlier as well about the, I'm asking if you would consider taking it to the deputy's level in regards to looking at the challenges in rural Nova Scotia in regards to attracting those professionals I talked about earlier. And I'm asking if you take it to the table to the other deputies in regards to looking at opportunities to try to help rural communities find opportunities for spouses as well who are professionals. I know this, over the past week, I had an opportunity to talk to one of the organizations in Nova Scotia that represents a group of professionals. And they do a tremendous job. And I didn't realize until I spoke to them actually what they will do in that regard. And I just think there's probably opportunities there today, but I don't think there's a link presently, you know, that would kind of marry those issues together. And I think if at your level, if you could bring that to the deputy's table, whether it's, you know, a psychiatrist for Cumberland County or whether it's maybe it's a GP for Yarmouth, I think you would find that there probably are resources out there that somehow we could bring those together. And again, I know these are huge challenges, and if it could have been easily resolved, would have been done a long time ago, and it wasn't. And I do applaud the efforts of your department if you can follow some of those concerns of mine on behalf of the residents that I represent and try to find some solutions. It was mentioned earlier about the about community services. Does community services, and maybe I missed, does community services actually receive any direct amount of monies in their budget that you're aware of for mental health? For example, in Cumberland County, would they have any monies that would come from your department but flow through maybe through their own budgeting process that would be allocated for mental health services?
I'm not sure of what's in their budget, but it would be through their own resource. I can't answer that question for you, I'm sorry.
But none from your department that you're aware of?
It wouldn't come from us to community services.
From health, yeah. And maybe the strategy, we'll take a look at this issue, but...
You have just 30 seconds.
Oh, so very quickly. I think there are other issues that face professionals locating to rural areas. In this article in the Chronicle Herald, they talk about, I think it was this one I looked at, they talked about transportation issues, no affordable transportation. So there are many, many, many issues. I think that it seems like the solution is very simple, but very often it's very complex. And I just hope that, I don't know the strategy, we'll take a look at these other issues as well. Can you tell me if you believe it will or not, Deputy, if other issues in rural Nova Scotia will be considered besides just the issue of mental health?
We'll look at as many issues as we can get in there.
We'll see that you have those. Thank you, sir. Thanks for your time.
Thank you very much. And I'll turn the floor over now to Mr. Pereira for the NDP caucus.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. It's a fascinating area and so complex. I have just a few questions. I wanted to go back to the Auditor General's report as it relates to performance measures. It seems to me that there's a great deal of value in that report, because the Auditor General says, you know, on one hand, he's been tasked with the idea of looking at whether government expenditures are done in accordance with established standards and processes and what the legislature has approved. And on the other hand, you have standards that are fairly vague and, you know, vague to the point of where they're almost unenforceable, if not immeasurable. And I thought I heard you say that, you know, you're going to go back to revisit those standards to see whether or not they're accurate, whether or not they're realistic, whether or not they conform with, you know, the evidence that you have since that those standards were set. And I'm wondering how are you doing that? It doesn't seem to me it's something that's peculiar to Nova Scotia, and whether or not you know, you have some international measures or national measures that you're using or can use to sort of meet what the Auditor General is saying, you know, clarify those standards, make them measurable so that we can actually understand to what extent we are meeting the standards we ourselves set.
I'm going to turn it over to Patricia to talk about specifics, but from a department point of view, what we've been working hard on is trying to come up with areas where we can measure and hold accountable DHAs or other entities that we're working with. And we've been working hard to make sure that accountability is an important part of the department's work, whether it's for dollars, whether it's for programs. It is a lot of work because I think in the past, not that it was done with bad intentions, I think we move from one project to the next without going back and make sure we crossed all our T's and dotted all our I's, and so we are changing our system and our philosophy and culture to make sure that's included. But for the specific of your question, I'm going to ask Patricia to answer. Okay.
Ms. Murray.
Thank you. The standards we developed, just to clarify, are service delivery standards as opposed to clinical practice standards. So they outline things like what type of professionals need to be delivering the service, and we're quite clear about that, and I would say those standards are well respected. For example, we don't have anything lower than a master's prepared clinician offering individual treatment and doing so autonomously. We also have set out specific wait times, and those are quite measurable, and that's what we're beginning to look at more carefully now that we have computer programs and that sort of thing in place, that we can actually take a close look at that across the province and be able to compare it. But the standards have been in place for quite some time, and people are well aware of them. The districts are well aware of those. What we're doing now is sitting down with the standards and going through them statement by statement to say, is there any way that we can sort of operationalize that and really come up with a clear measure of what are we doing? So the first ones we looked at, for example, were our prevention, promotion, and advocacy ones, and what specific things can we do to assist with that? We've become quite involved with the Mental Health First Aid program, and so we can say we can ensure that there are mental health first aid trainers in every district, and we can make that available and offer so many sessions a year and that kind of thing. So those kinds of things are more measurable. And we'll just walk ourselves through all of the standards, and wherever we think that we can put closer parameters around them and make them more measurable, we will do that. But they have been reviewed on a regular basis, and they're certainly best practice in terms of service delivery. So I wouldn't want to give the impression that we haven't looked at them since 2003. We look at them regularly, and we bring together a group of people to sort of edit them and update them every 3 to 5 years. So we have gone through all of them, I believe, just to make sure they're very solid in terms of the content. And now we have to go back and see, okay, how can we define even the language around it and the specifics to make sure they're easier to measure.
So it is a work in progress, and I guess you have to be commended for trying and striking out at that time and, you know, establishing benchmarks to provide for accountability. But it's clearly both, something the Auditor General has flagged, but also from an accountability question, we need to know whether or not we are delivering, you know, services in the most effective way. The member from Cape Breton North asked a number of questions about related strategies, and it seems to me, just in listening to his questions and the subsequent questions from other members, that mental health strategy is connected to so many other strategies, and although it seems desirable that we deal with all these silos and break down those barriers, but at the same time, there's just so much complexity in that there are so many people involved in it, and that there's difficult to attach how much we're actually spending on mental health issues. I have a more specific question about the child and youth strategy, and particularly issues relating to young people in junior high and our ability to identify kids at risk early. At the time, there was quite, at least at the time of the Nunn inquiry, there was, you know, he said there was a real gap there between what the Department of Education was doing and what the Department of Health was doing, and they didn't seem to know that there were services available. Can we expect, or are we seeing any progress in that part of it, and making sure that we detect these issues early and provide support where it's needed for kids at risk?
I'm going to, again, get Patricia to talk to specific, but just to go back to my previous role as a CEO before coming in as deputy for social health, mental health services actually were in the schools working with the staff before to try and identify issues, working with teachers' aides, and then also from that, working with the individuals who do require assistance. So some work is being done in the districts, but from a provincial perspective, I'll let Patricia answer.
There is a Schools Plus pilot project in place, I believe, in four areas around the province. I think South Shore is one of them. I think Cumberland might be one of them, and the Strait Regional School Board, and in Halifax. And the idea behind that is to have a lot of services that children and youth require available either in the school or have it accessible through the people at the school. So there's a coordinator in these schools, and they connect with all of the various resources that might be available, including mental health. And I know mental health has played an active role in that to make sure that they are identified early. If they can be treated in the school, fine, through some programming they have there, or they're referred on to the more formal clinic. There are teen health centers. They're not always in junior high. Sometimes high schools are junior and senior high in more rural areas, so they may cover both. But I know there's been a push on to have as many teen health centers as possible available around the school, around the province and schools, and I think that's been a huge help. They do identify that mental health is one of their larger topic areas that they deal with. I also know that the Department of Education is introducing a new curriculum, a mental health curriculum that's been developed, again, by Dr. Bianca Horner. And I believe it can start in elementary school, but it certainly starts in junior high. And it's not mandated, but it is an option. And it has a very clear curriculum guide for teachers who may not be comfortable or familiar with mental health issues. And then it has workbooks for the students themselves. And we've reviewed that, and that's actually a very excellent resource. And the Department of Education has introduced that into the schools. So I think there's lots of things ongoing. I think the Child and Youth Strategy certainly shone a light on the need for the needs of children and youth sort of across, you know, from really conception on. And so the strategy itself has tried to fund pilot projects and then carry those forward across those various age groups, and are continuing to do so.
Thank you. I have a couple more questions about, just follow-up questions from questions that were asked earlier. Now, Mr. McNamara, you were asked to comment on the Boots on the Street program, and I know that this is not in your area of expertise, but I did want to correct a statement that the member from Cape Breton North made. The Boots on the Street program has not been canceled. There are officers who have been allocated to Cape Breton. In fact, there are seven officers who have been put in place in the Cape Breton Regional Municipality. But it's the first time I've seen the Boots on the Street program referred to as a mental health strategy, as a component of the mental health strategy. But in any case, I did want to correct that because I know you couldn't be expected to answer a question in that area. I also had a comment about the request for the various parties involved in the gaming strategy, and I think that's a question that's more appropriately answered by the Department of Finance, just as to who would be consulted and who would be involved in that in that strategy. No, it's kind of you to agree, but I assume that you will be part of the strategy, but not leading that. That strategy.
Just on that, maybe I can just for Mr. Clark's benefit in the committee, I did mislead a little bit, and I thought I might have when I said, but the individuals that are involved are deputies from finance, health protection and promotion, labor workforce development, as well as CEOs from the Office of Aboriginal Affairs, the Nova Scotia Gaming Corporation. So that's who the members on the committee are.
There you go. I got it clarified for you, I believe, which is useful. But I think we do need to find out where this, who the parties to this agreement will be, and it's just more properly directed to the Department of Finance. We try to help the opposition from time to time as well. Ms. Murray, I'm really glad you mentioned the teen health centers because I have personal experience with them at JL Ilsley, and that's a fabulous program, and to get kids directly involved in peer counseling and learning to help their classmates is just wonderful, and I've seen the success there, so I think it is a good idea, and I applaud you for supporting that and for mentioning it. And while we're on the subject, I also should say that the mobile crisis unit in my constituency, and I guess in across Nova Scotia. I don't know how widespread it is, but does a fantastic job of dealing with issues as they arise. You know, you get a call from someone saying they're contemplating suicide, and the mobile crisis unit is right there to give you advice and support and deal with it. And so, you know, where people reach those services, they're just exceptional, and it's a question of how do we expand it. Similar with Direction 180 and Phoenix House and the Department of Education has its own program. So I know we tend to sometimes look for more that you can do, but what is being done is also pretty commendable. I had a question about the connection to emergency response services. And again, it's another example of different things that are all going on simultaneously. But Dr. Ross is looking at mental health in part as well, and mental health treatment in emergency rooms. Are you able to comment on what we are looking for there and where we might go? Not to anticipate Dr. Ross, but...
I can't anticipate his fund, but one of the things we did ask them to look at is how individuals showing up in emergency, how they do access to service, and how they get referred appropriately once they arrive at an emergency room. One of the difficulties at times is that individuals who require mental health services need to be looked at in a different way in order to ensure that they are safe, they're protected, and they get the appropriate treatment as quick as possible. So that's one of the things that we've asked Dr. Ross to look at.
I believe I have a minute. I have a question, and I don't understand the answer to the earlier question. There was a $23 million gap identified in 2007-2008 between what was expected to be provided and what, in fact, was provided. Does the Auditor General have access to information in terms of how much a program will cost relative to the department's budget? You know, because we have, the Department of Health is a huge, it's a huge, complex department, and I'm wondering how you identify gaps in particular areas, given that you're looking at an overall budget as well that has fairly significant gaps and needs.
My understanding, the information provided was provided to the Auditor General by our department. It was based on our best projections, based on the standards that were outlined and what we thought it would cost to get there. It's not, again, it's not 100% accurate, but it's our best estimate on a go forward.
Okay, I believe I have 1 second and it's done.
That's it. Thank you very much, Mr. Pereira. I appreciate that. And that concludes our questions today for the witnesses on the mental health services issue. As is our practice, I'd like to give you a couple of minutes, if you would like, Mr. McNamara, to just sum up or have some concluding remarks.
Just very quickly. First, I'd like to thank the committee and the Auditor General, first for bringing mental health to the front of mind. I think it's important that as we look at what are the options that government is going to deal with on a go-forward basis, and as well with the support of all parties, is how we can allocate any resource that we may have available to us. And the one of the issues around mental health is with the stigma, as many people have talked about, is that sometimes when you're looking at whether you spend your money on a new drug, a piece of equipment, or a new program, mental health doesn't get the priority. And such as this helps the department, helps the minister in moving that agenda forward. So we do appreciate that. We also appreciate the support of many of the advocates. And it was mentioned Cecilia McCrae, and I know Stephen Eyre and others. That is very helpful to us as well in trying to look at what we can do in the future. But I can tell you there's a sincere commitment from the minister, from the department and our staff to advocate for mental health services as we go forward. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. McNamara. And also, I speak for the whole committee in saying that we're very pleased to see it getting more prominence, the whole issue of mental health services. The fact that a mental health strategy is beginning is a very positive thing. And I know we'll all wait with anticipation to see what suggestions are made. But I think we do need to be bold in identifying the best practices and trying to improve Nova Scotia's services for people who need this help with mental illness. There were a couple of requests for information. I think we may have had an answer on the gaming strategy. strategy question. The other question I had was if you could check with Doctors Nova Scotia and see what the contract allows for any, if there is a special provision for mental health visits at a family doctor. So that's very important to us as well. And with that, if you, we have a little bit of committee business. If you would like to leave, that's just fine. Thank you very much again for joining us today. On the committee business, before we adjourn for a few minutes and then come back for agenda setting, I just wanted to draw your attention to the three items of information that we have received from previous meetings. One from the Workers' Compensation Board, which is quite extensive, one from South Shore Health, and the third is from the Sydney Tarpons. So if everybody has received that, that's just to draw your attention to it. I'd like to adjourn just to 11 o'clock and have the full committee back for agenda setting at that time. So with that, could I have a motion to adjourn? Thank you very much, and we'll return. Well done.
Mm-hmm.